We got the twins today.
Book of Revelation, chapter 7, verses 16 and 17.
Yeah.
They shall hunger
Brother
no more,
Kev.
Neither shall they thirst anymore.
Preach up.
Yep. God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes.
Yes,
get ready for the revolution.
Welcome to the Churchfolk Revolution Radio with your host TJ, Sister Liberty, and Brother Lee. This is the only radio station of its kind that will hold pastors, priests, and preachers accountable. Ultimately, we believe that God will deal with them. Until then, we plan to deal with them right now. So feel free to call the show or just sit back and listen. The revolution is now being televised. Enjoy the show.
The revolution is now being televised, and this is for Prevention Week, and we're going to take topics related to how to prevent your man from becoming a whore. Or kill him, cure him. If he's already whoring out, we want to deal with it today on the Church Folk Revolution, because we're not a church show. We are a show about church. And to help me on this show here today, I recruited some people, man. I went out and I put out a blast on the revolution and said I need some brothers who are not afraid to stand up and talk about themselves in the most intricate areas of their business. You know, only two people raised their hand. Yeah, the general, he gonna be checking in as soon as the Pope of the Baptist people put him on. But I got the twin. We know him as the flaming sword of the revolution. What's happening, man?
What's happening, man? I'm here. I'm not queer, and we ready to do this. Let's do this, man.
Today, guys, if you're new to the show, to the Church Folk Revolution, we take on topics that are relevant to church. We take on topics that we don't feel they discuss in church. And this is all a part of our Church Folk Revolution, in which we begin to spark a revolution into the minds of those that sit in the pews. And there are issues that are facing our families that we feel are not being discussed while our preachers are concerned. Assume with prosperity and money, we figured that it's best that, being that they are preoccupied with getting rich, somebody needs to take on the hard work of the ministry. So to help me with that, I bring in my boy Flaming Swart, because he's always out there doing the hard work of the ministry. And before we dive too far in it, man, did you enjoy your holiday yesterday, Swart?
Man, I enjoyed it. It was grand, man. It was grand. It was a wonderful, wonderful Thanksgiving, man. I got to eat. I went off my diet for a little while, man. I just said, forget it.
How far?
You know?
A block off or 5 miles off? How far?
I felt about half a mile off.
A half a mile off? That ain't that bad. We can fix
that. Okay. Yeah, you know, I had a plan, man, to go from Biggie Smalls
to LL Cool J.
And I kind of went back towards Biggie Smalls, but I'm going to get back on track.
Absolutely, absolutely, man.
That was yours, man. That was
pretty good, bro. I didn't think Rennell was going to, it's 7 o'clock come. I said, Rennell, you going to wake up, you going to cook, or what we going to do? Going to have nothing to eat? I'm going to cook. I don't need you to be telling me, reminding me that I need to cook. I'm like, I'm just saying that. And I'm not saying that you got to cook. I'm saying it's Thanksgiving, and people typically eat on this day. But if you sleeping.
Right. So what time did y'all eat?
She came during the midnight hour, bro, like at 1:58 p.m.
Okay. So it's like 2 o'clock, like the normal time to eat Thanksgiving dinner.
It was almost Thanksgiving dinner. She was coming in about 11:59, bro. We sitting around there looking about starved, you know what I'm saying? Watching people on TV eating. So she got it through, and it was a wonderful meal. We had gumbo. And we introduced Brother Lee to gumbo for the first time. He done woke up this morning and ate gumbo for breakfast. We like, whoa, dude, you don't eat that for breakfast, bro.
He ate gumbo for breakfast.
Brother Lee ate gumbo for breakfast, man. Dude, you don't. So Brother Lee's stomach probably going to be tore up.
Wow. So, he got PGs, huh? So he had
for the weekend. You know, but guys, we take it on a topic today. We take it on a hard hitting topic, and I titled this show that way not for shock value, but because it's what we want to do. We want to get down into this topic of man whore. We want to get down into this topic of men who run in women. We want to get down into this topic of men who can't be with one woman. And especially those of us that are of the Christian beliefs in our inability to commit to one woman. Why is it so hard to only have sex with one woman? And a lot of us struggle. A lot of brothers have problems with that. A lot of us, you know, yes, we have a good woman, and it's not an indictment on her, but at the same time, we have the inability to say no to new woman. Today, we want to talk about new woman, we want to talk about your existing woman, we want to talk about what made you cheat when you cheated. When you cheated on her, why you cheated on her? What made you cheat on her? What made you creep? What made you get in the car and get at 12:59 a.m. telling your wife you're going to check on boo-boo because you think boo-boo in trouble, knowing you're not going to see boo-boo? You're going to roll by your boo. We want to talk about it. But before we get too far heavy in this sword, can you open us up in prayer?
Absolutely. Father, we just come to you now in the name of Jesus. We thank you for this opportunity for us to come together as men, Lord God, and talk about these things, Lord God. For as men, Father, it is up to us, Father God, to talk to other men, to let them know that it's not okay to be to cheat on their woman, Lord God, to cheat on their wife. I'm not going to say woman, but to cheat on their wives, Lord God. We want everybody to be, Father God, that's under the sound of our voice, if I could use that phrase, Lord God, yes, to hear and understand what we are saying, Lord God, that you call the nuclear family one man and one woman, Lord God. And we want it to be that way, Lord God. So as we expose our own past, Lord God, we want people to see and realize that we're not perfect, but we have come to the point in our lives, Lord God, where we have sold our royal oath and we are committed to one woman. We will no longer play the harlot. And we hope that a man that will hear this will no longer play the harlot either. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus'
name. Amen.
And let the church folk revolution say amen. Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Yes. Welcome. To the Church Folk Revolution Radio. Yes, we are the Church Folk Revolution. We're not a church show. We are a show hosted by believers in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we discuss every aspect of church. Things that church folk don't want church folk to talk about, we talk about. And on this particular subject, being that there are so many whores within the faith, we figured that it's only fitting that we take on this topic, because a lot of the people when I was out there wilding out, those people were Christians. Okay, I wasn't wilding out with Muslims. I wasn't wilding out with Jews. I was wilding out with Christian women. Okay, some of whom were married, some of whom were single. Any case scenario, it didn't matter to me because I was an equal opportunity whore. Anyone, it didn't matter your status, I would interact with you.
Wow. So TJ, you was whoring in the church?
That's where it started. That's where it started. It started in church, mainly because there were abundance of women in church, right? And there were so many women in church that were looking for a good man.
Good man.
Okay. And church women are probably perhaps the easiest women to fool, because they are already in a place looking and seeking for a good man. When you go to the club, them chicks out there in the club are not necessarily looking for a good man. Matter of fact, the fact that they're meeting you in the club, number one, they don't trust you to start with. So they are, believe it or not, they are a little bit more work than somebody you meet in church, because church has conditioned her to think that the fact that I'm in church, I must be a good man. So, Brother Jay, that got me in. That's half of my work right there that church has already done for me. Church has done half of the work for me, because their perception is, and a lot of times, unfortunately, with women, as their perception goes, their body goes. And it's unfortunate. If they perceive that you are, A lot of times they lower their defenses. If they perceive that you are a good man, they lower their defenses. In some cases, before even checking out if you really are. Okay? And being that some women perception is also influenced by materialistic things, if you got some material, that also helps in lowering their defenses. So you're in church and you got materials. Okay?
Wow.
And she is looking and she's materialistic. I'm halfway there. Okay? So I wanted to start off this conversation first of all by explaining the how I per se was able to prey on women, because I am a former man whore.
Okay?
And I gotta first, before I talk about you and pass it to Jay the sword, I'm gonna first talk about me. I preyed on women, I preyed on sisters, right? And it almost became a sport or a game, right? And sometimes I tied up people's lives. Sometimes I flat out destroyed their lives or their dreams and hopes for a happy family. I destroyed that too. And it was an inability to make a decision on one woman because I had high taste in women. So, I've always told this to people. I've never been in a dilemma in between a good woman and a whore. I've always been in dilemma in between two good women. Right, so I would seek out good women, and I would have my share or more than my share of good women. Some cases I would have two, some cases I would have three. Rennell hates when I say this, but it is the truth. I say prior to meeting you, I had a three-woman-a-week habit.
Three a week?
And she would get mad. Why you always got to say that? You make me sick when you say that. Why you always got to say? Well, it's the truth, okay? I always tell her, would you want the ugly truth or a pretty lie? Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that women need to start adjusting themselves for the ugly truth, because the pretty lie is what allows guys like myself to get you all caught up. And a lot of times to get you caught up in a lot of stupidness, okay? A lot of get you caught up in a game that you don't even realize it's a game until either a year later, a baby later, or two women later, then you realize this is a game. So that's my opening. What about yours?
Well, mine was a little different from yours. I wasn't raised up in church. When I got in church, I was serious about it. As far as being that serious as I could. My stuff was in the streets, man. I got mine in the streets, man. I was bad. I used to be a dancer. And don't laugh. Well, you can laugh because it's funny.
I'm just holding.
Okay. Now, I'm going to tell you what I had a nickname. I had a stage name.
Go ahead, bro.
My stage name was, you ready?
I'm ready.
My stage name was Mr. Wetcha Draws.
Whoa.
Mr. Wetcha Draws. Because I used to tell him, one dance with me, and I bet you Wetcha Draws. I mean, I had it.
Rennell screaming from the other room. I hear.
Well, that was my name, man. Well, that was my name, Mr. Wetcha Draws.
You was a male stripper?
No, not a stripper. I used to dance in a group, but it was kind of... It was exotic, but not...
All right, cool. Cool.
Yeah. Not, but still, that was my name. But we used to dance, man, and I used to get them. Then being in the military too, it was easy. And I used to run them. I had game. I used to spit game like it wasn't nobody's business, and I had cheated like nobody's business. I could have wrote a book on cheating. All of my friends were getting caught because they were stupid, man. What was that movie? I forgot that Bill Bellamy was in How to Be a Player or something.
Yep.
How to Be a Player. And I was like, I could have wrote a book on how to cheat. Because a lot of us men, when we cheat stupidly.
Mm-hmm.
We cheat stupidly. But I was smart with my cheating. I never got caught. You know, and I almost got caught once. It was me. I was like my girlfriend. And I slept with her cousin and one of her friends. And it was easy. It was easy. And... one girl told, she snitched, but I just made out a big lie. Right. And it missed back in the day, BC, and I kind of threatened her real bad, like, you better shut up. But I was a man whore.
Right, and a whore.
And then, you know, that was it, man. That was it. By the way, I used to dance. Women used to automatically assume that I was, you know, good in the bed.
Mm-hmm.
And that made it a lot easier for me to get women. Made it easy.
Right. Right.
Made it easy.
Because if you got a hook, if you got something, you know, it makes it that easier. Whether it's a nice job or it's a nice car or it's something that sets you aside or makes you distinguished, then that also leads to women lowering their defenses. And, you know, I've always wondered, you know, why haven't the female, if in the terms of just from a nature perspective, you know, why haven't they evolved to the point where these things no longer work? Such as in nature, if you look at animals that are preyed upon, they eventually evolve and they develop defense mechanisms
mm-hmm.
that make those predators' jobs that much more difficult.
Right. They adapt.
They adapt. But it just seems that the same game is still working. Like, example, yesterday I'm talking to my daughter, right? My daughter's 17, trying to date, you know, and she trying to date this little dude. All right, they call themselves dating, you know, that scared me to death because I'm like, okay, my grandma said this thing about, you know, what you did gonna come back on you, you know. So she said this, you know, a while back, just remember now you got a daughter, so with all this stuff you're doing, it's gonna come back on you, you know, so now I'm scared to death because I got a daughter, you know, my daughter's 17 years old, you know, and she's a beautiful girl, and I'm like, you know, and I'm talking to her yesterday because I'm under this pressure to make sure she is aware of the game, you know, are you aware of the game, you know, and so I'm talking to her yesterday, and I say, sweetie, I said, I understand. I said, you and this boy trying to date. You know, I ain't too happy about that, but she's 17 now, you know, and I don't want her just plain stupid to men. You know what I'm saying? And so I said, do you believe that you are the only girl he's seeing? Daddy, yeah. I said, what makes you so? Because I know I am. I said, okay. I say, how do you know you're the only woman or girl he's dating? Because he wouldn't cheat. He wouldn't do none of these things like you think he's going to do, Daddy. He's different.
Hmm. Wow.
I said, Maya, you know how many women I've dated who thought they were the only one?
Hmm.
But, Daddy, he's different from you.
Hmm. He a man.
I said, and that could be the case. He could be different. I said, but I want you to do me a favor. When you find out that you're not, I don't want you busting out the windows in his car. I don't want you to key up his car. I don't want you to do all of that stuff. I just want you to remember what I'm telling you right now, that you're way too young to be so serious with this one particular person. I said, baby, would he like at 17? He not going to like at 27.
Mm-hmm.
And he's sure, and he's definitely not going to like it at 37. So if you think that y'all are going to hook up right now and be together forever, it's a slim possibility of that. And, you know, so I'm having this conversation with my daughter, and I'm seeing that we have a caller. But I'm reminded of why I was wilding out, and I'm reminding of when I was wilding out, and reminding of the things that I was doing and the things that I was saying to women,
mm-hmm.
right, or saying to multiple women at the same time, you know. And I've shared this story before. It wasn't until I was older in life that somebody helped me understand, and it wasn't a preacher. Like, I wish it would have been a preacher.
A what?
Yeah, a preacher. You know, I really wish it would have been, you know. But it wasn't a preacher that helped me understand why I was doing it. Like, because really, really, bro, I didn't understand why I could not commit to one woman.
Hmm. Did you want to, though?
Initially. Yeah, like, okay. Initially when I met each one of them, I wanted to. Like, everyone that I've met initially, I was like, you know what? I'm gonna chill with just her. Is this gonna be me and her? ain't going to be nobody else but me and her. And then on cue, the moment, it's like the moment would say that, or a moment thought would enter into my mind, here come Pretty Hair Big Booty.
Uh-oh.
In front of me.
Brenda got a big old butt.
You know what I'm saying? Nah, I got to step. You know, for those of you who don't know what stepping is, that's approaching a woman with the intention of dating her. So now I got to step to her. You know, baby, let me holler at you. I want to holler. Let me holler. I just want to holler at you. Baby, let me holler, right? So now I got two. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now I got two. So now I was doing real good with the one. I was spending time with one, hanging out with one, didn't have nothing to worry about, didn't have to worry about when my cell phone go off, you know, is it her, didn't have to worry about, you know, an email or something coming through, you know, that's going to possibly bust me because I'm only with her. Now I'm with two. So now I'm lying to one to be with the other.
Oh.
Now my patterns have changed. Now the things about me have changed. Now some of the things I used to do, I no longer do anymore because my time, emotion, feelings, everything has become diluted.
Hmm. So let me ask you real quick. Now, were you just in it to have sex with them, or were you in it to actually date them?
No, for me, bro, I like the dating part.
What about yourself? Me, it was all about sex with me. I wasn't trying to date nobody.
All right.
And I wasn't in it to, like, well, you said you were trying to get in. My whole thing was, when I say step, my thing was, how quick can I get the draws?
Right.
That was my focus. Uh-huh.
Quite natural. And for some sisters, that's not that long.
Right.
You know,
right.
It takes a while, you know. But in a lot of cases, like you, the women who tried to dangle it in front of me, they made it a sport. Like, they made it a game. Like, you know, I'm going to possibly give it to you, then I'm not, then I'm possibly, then I'm thinking I'm getting closer. Then it became a game, you know what I'm saying? Because you're trying to jerk me along. And, you know, when I sit back and I look at it, you know, when I sit back and I look at it now, that the smoke is clear. Like this Sherman's March to the Sea of Horn that I was on, you know, now that all of the everything has settled and I look back on it and I'm like, man, you was a monster, bro. Like, you was like real. You looking at me, you wouldn't tell that I was a monster. Like the people who was involved with me, they wouldn't have known that I'm a monster. But now I'm in monster prevention that I have a daughter. Okay, you know what I'm saying? Now I'm trying to make her immune to a monster. Like, now I'm trying to get her to be able to recognize a monster before he bites you. And I'm finding that now my daughter is now just as vulnerable as some of the women that I preyed on, you know? And it, I don't know, brother, that within itself is a whole different dynamic to this conversation, because, you know, because of the fact that all of the horn that we do, we eventually grow up as men, and now we have kids.
Right.
You know, and then now you begin to look at, okay, how am I going to prevent my son from going down this road? How am I going to prevent my daughter from getting popped? You know what I'm saying? And it's crazy, but we got a caller. We got a caller today, brother. Call from 438. 438. Your call is live today. We're talking about the man whore, especially the one that exists in the church. What's your take on the conversation?
Hello, Stanley from New York. Great show, like usual. Always great to see.
Thank you.
Please continue,
what's up, Stan?
Please continue your show. You always do great conversation. I wish more pastor would do conversation like you do every day. They talk about church.
Talking about the
subject today, I gotta say that we got to be honest. Let's be honest for once and everything. Monogamy is not natural. We all know that. It's been proven biologically. It's been proven by research. It's been proven that monogamy becomes a choice that you decide to do in your life. Not everybody is going to make that choice. It takes, if you're going to be monogamous with only one person, you got to make damn sure that person fills up every need that you need. And I'm sorry to say, a lot of guys and a lot of people who are married and everything find out later, either they find out they're married with somebody who's not sexually compatible, They're not emotionally compatible. They're not, in a lot of ways, not compatible. And that's when the cheating starts. That's when the guy is saying to his woman, or the woman, both cheating start because they realize we're not at the same level in different things. And to ask a man or a woman to stay there and be faithful, especially in 2011, when there is so many Facebook, Twitter, things online, porn, you name it, women dressing up in every way, clubs, dancing scene, this and that, to be faithful, you gotta be a strong man to be faithful. We cannot compare to the 1960s, we cannot compare to the 1950s, when marriage was like, when you were married to somebody, it wasn't the same thing. We cannot compare to the same thing. So for us to say that, oh, well, I heard one of the callers that wants to prepare his son, because he wants to prepare his son to not have the same road as him, I think you need to prepare his son to say, you know what, you need to learn what you want in a woman, and you need to date a lot of women to find out what you need. And once you find the right woman for you, are you sure that you're going to be faithful? Are you sure you're ready to make that commitment? Then do the thing that you need to do. But it's not by meeting one woman and staying by one woman that you will know as a man that you found the woman that's right for you.
Let me ask you a question.
A lot of women that you will.
Let me ask you a question. I definitely I appreciate the call and respect your opinion 100%, and that's why we have this show. We allow people to share their opinions, which is something they don't always get a chance to do in church. My question to you is, have you ever cheated, got caught?
Yes, I have.
And why? What made you cheat on your woman? I know you explained it in your opening, but that particular woman that you had, what made you cheat on her?
Because I wasn't man enough to tell her the truth about some stuff that she needed to improve, and I wasn't man enough to tell her that it's either you do that or it's not going to work. I wasn't man enough. I wanted to have my cake and eat it too. I wanted to keep this woman because she was good in a lot of other things. She wasn't good in a couple of other things, but she was good in a lot of things that I found that was great. And I said, you know what? I'll keep her because she's a great woman and everything. I still love her. I still care about her. But as a human nature, I'll still look at, I won't get caught. I'll be okay. I'll invade. I'll do it. And I got caught. And did I hurt this woman? Yes. Do I regret that I did? Of course I'll say I regret that I did. But I'm not going to act like I was all humble. I didn't do what I needed to do. I didn't tell that woman I wasn't ready. A lot of people are not ready to be in one relationship with one person. A lot of people.
So do you think that monogamy is a good thing or a bad thing?
It's a good thing if you're sure that you're ready to do that commitment. It's a good thing if you're sure that you're ready to sit down with that person and say, look, let me look at the five things that are important. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, intellectually, things that you think are important. Does that person accomplish those things? And if it doesn't, you have a problem in the relationship.
Uh-huh.
I'm not saying that, you know, and when you have a problem in that relationship and that opened that door, trust me, especially in 2011, you will find there is always going to be another woman outside that's going to be more good-looking, more this, more that than your partner. It is for you to know, am I ready to be faithful to that point? And if you're not ready to be faithful to that point, don't do it. That's the thing I have to say to all the guys. Don't do it.
Yeah,
a lot of guys are not ready.
Yeah, I think it comes down to us being selfish, man. It's about us being selfish. Like you said, she had lined up with four things, but the one thing, maybe it's the sex thing. Everything else she okay, but the sex ain't banging. So at that point, as a man, we need to stand up and say, honey, well, you need to do this a little better, or can you try this? Instead of putting her off and going to try to have sex with somebody else, we need to make what we got work, especially if you're married. Now, we don't know if you're talking about married or single.
Yeah. married.
I understand what you're saying, but that depends. If you have a marriage with somebody you could be honest with and won't take it personally, yeah, it's good for you. But how many guys do you know come to their wife and tell them things that, you know, in my heart, I want to tell you the truth, and the woman will go on you and yell at you and say, who are you to tell me those things? Won't even man up to the guy and say, you know what, my husband or my boyfriend has the right to tell me things that maybe I don't want to hear, but at least he's being honest about it. If you're not encouraging honesty, don't be surprised that your man or your husband will do things behind your back, because your man and your husband will know what is your reaction when he's honest with you. Man,
hey, brother.
Hey,
man, thank you so much, brother. As always, we appreciate your call. And,
thank you.
Thanks for getting our conversation started. We appreciate it, man. Thank you very much. And this brother makes some he makes some good points, and one of the points that I can agree with is that I wasn't always straight up. I didn't tell the person how I was really feeling, you know, and there were opportunities for me to save some of those relationships or that I missed. I mean, I'm totally missed because I wasn't straight up. And that's why I wanted to ask him why. Why did you do it? And you mentioned earlier, bro, that it was the sex. Okay? And as I hone in a little bit more, Sword, was there a woman that you were involved with that it wasn't about sex or just the sex and you got caught in that situation?
No, it was always about sex with me.
It's always about sex.
I'm just to be honest, I haven't had many girlfriends. I probably in my whole life maybe five. And they were long term, but I cheated on every single one of them. Now I had my girl at home. She was doing what she needed to do and wasn't married. You know, she was doing what she needed to do. But as a man, I was just greedy. I wanted to get my notch on and get that locker room talk with, yeah, I got this one, and she did this, and she did that. That's what it was about at that time in my life. That's what it was about.
What made you stop chasing after the sex?
Yeah, I would say it was maturity. Actually, I didn't until I got married. I cheated on every girl. Like, it was only about five girlfriends, but every single one of them I had, I cheated on them until I got married. I always made that vow with myself that I would never cheat on my wife, and I didn't get my wife until actually I got saved. So that kind of helped a lot.
All right. So for you being serious about being saved and your wife, but I got to ask this question. What was it about her that was satisfying?
I think it didn't have nothing to do with her. It was me. It had nothing to do with her. It was me and my selfish needs, my wants. And she was enough, because if I had that same mindset that I had back then, she would not be enough. But I had to get some things right within me. I had to realize that I can be with one woman. And I don't need nothing else. You know, and it's not worth. And I'm going to be at an 8-second climax, because that's really what it's about. 8-second, 6-second climax. That's the goal.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not worth me losing my family, paying no alimony, not missing out on the life of my kid. It ain't worth all that. For 8 seconds, 6 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's just something in me. So it had nothing to do with my wife, and it had nothing to do with them other women. It was what I wanted.
What about that sister that catches your eye?
Looked good. Oh yeah.
How do you stop from stepping, like, even right now? I know you're married. I know we got a lot of men married. I know you got a good woman. We got a lot of men with good women. But when you see that sister, whether it's at work, whether it's, you know, just in your daily interaction, could be somebody in a one-on-one business situation, and she's hitting on all areas. What stops you from approaching her?
The first thing that stops is the fear of the Lord. That's first and foremost in my mind. Is the fear of God stops me. But beyond that,
that's organ.
It's her. You said it's organ. Organ words. Hey.
That's organ worthy, right?
Yeah. That's the first thing. It's the freak of the Lord.
Yes.
I don't want to do that to God. But then think about my wife. I think about her, and I don't want to put her through any kind of hurt. I don't want to be the one to make her go through that much pain. I don't want to, and it just ain't worth it. And she might look good. She might be hitting on this stuff. But when you really get to know somebody, you get to know all their good parts and all of their bad parts. Because she might look good on the outside. Might be good at work and all this stuff. But when you get to know her, she got problems. She got issues, insecurities. She crazy. She could be a thin line, a stalker. Mm-hmm. You never know what you're going to get. And it just ain't worth it.
Yes,
bro. Some very good questions, man.
You know, and I got one more for you along those same lines, and it's really building off of this guy's statement he made, our caller from New York, and I really thank that brother for bringing some interesting elements to the conversation. How a lot of men cheat because, like he said, whether you like what he was saying or not, he said something. He said, there was things about her that I wasn't honest about that I wanted, and I'm just paraphrasing, that I wanted to be better, okay?
Mm-hmm.
What about a time in your marriage when your wife wasn't doing it, doing certain things? I'm not just talking about sex. I'm just talking about across the board. The way you wanted them done, how did you handle that? And why didn't you go out and find the 20%? I know you explained you didn't go out and find the 20% to do that part. How did you enter into this conversation or approach your wife when you know what? Hey, you're just not cutting it right here.
You know what? And just to be totally honest, it's still some things that she don't do that I wish she would do. And just being honest.
Right.
And I'm pretty sure some things that it's some things that I don't do that she wish I could do.
Right.
But we got to be able to work together, and we got to talk, man. And what's one thing that me and my wife have decided to do, like, we was at a point at right around 7 years, man, we was talking divorce,
mm-hmm.
you know, but we had made it to a point, we ain't go to no counselors, we ain't need all, we sat down and we actually talked.
It worked
and
it out.
Listen. So now what we do, every Sunday night, we get together and we talk about the week. We say, well, you know, I don't like how you did that, but I do like how you did this. And we talk, and it said some feelings might get hurt, but we got to get it out there. So let's talk mm-hmm. about this. Mm-hmm. And that's what we do now. We talk. We talk.
Right. And that's a great thing because it gives you an opportunity to share with your woman, you know, why you're feeling that there's a deficiency. And for me, this is going to sound crazy to you, so what I'm about to say. The main reason I cheated on women was for the compliments.
Oh, the compliments that you would get?
The compliments that I would get from her, right? So here, this was the high. This was the rush. I'm taking you into the rush, right? The addiction to women. You meet a new chick, right? And I'm sorry to say, chick, I don't mean to offend nobody. Y'all know I'm on the wall,
right.
And we say stuff crazy, right? You meet a new woman, right? And she is that period of time when she's very, very excited about you, right?
Mm-hmm.
There is this moment when you meet a woman for the first time, you know, and y'all are starting that first little period right there. Everything that you do is wonderful, okay? She like everything, and she's constantly expressing to you that I like it, you know, because she's probably coming off a period where she was single for a while. So here you come, Mr. Movie, Mr. Nice Restaurant, Mr., you know, taking the drive to Biloxi in the nice car. Here you come, right? And you're spending this quality time with her that she didn't have while she was coming off of her period of single, okay? And she begins to verbally express, you know, I really like this, or this feels really good. Oh, you're so wonderful. Oh, you're so sweet. Oh, you're just, oh, you know?
Right.
And
playing that ego.
I like that, right? You know,
mm-hmm.
I like, I'm egotistical. You know, I like that, you know, because she's constantly saying these things, right? But over a period of time, they get used to those things. right? So now she's not as impressed anymore by these things that I'm doing. Now those things have become her expectation, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So now the compliments done stop, okay? Here I am off again to get some more compliments, right?
I gotcha.
So now I got a new little chick, right? Everything I do for her is wonderful. Oh, look at you, so sweet. Oh, oh, you're just so cool. You're just so sweet. Oh, okay. Here I go. Right? As one begins to decrease in the compliments, I got another one coming up with some more compliments. Okay? And the one that totally fails to compliment me at that point, I phase her out. Okay? Now I got two complimenting me all the time. Okay? Well, this is the behavior and the pattern of a very broken person filled with a big old void.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
And there are a lot of women who encounter men like this, but they don't know he's a man like that. Okay? When they realize that he's a man like that, they have already stopped complimenting him, and he's already found someone else. It wasn't the sex. Okay?
Okay.
Because even during sex, what made the sex the best sex for me is not what she did during sex, it's what she said during sex.
Okay.
I'm back on the compliments again, all right? Sooner or later, y'all going to see there's a method to this madness that I was in. What made it the best sex wasn't what she was doing, because basically all of them doing basically something like the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
But all of them say something different. Mm-hmm. They all are going to say something different in a certain way. I'm not talking about, I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about porno. I'm talking about the intimate things that were said during that moment, during those moments. You know, that fed the addiction. There are certain women that can say something during intimate times and completely mess a man up. Mess him completely up. A lot of the men who cheated on some of these sisters that are listening to the show, it wasn't even his intention to get caught up. He very well just said, well, I'm just going to hit it, quit it, go on about his business. But she said something. She said something during them 15 minutes. During that little time frame, she said something. Now he's in a dilemma in between his wife and your girl.
Because his wife don't see it, huh?
Because the things that you were doing has become her expectation. And I'm not saying that it's right, okay? I'm not saying what I'm saying to say that it's right. But I think that sisters need to be introduced to these types of men, okay? And anytime you have a man who is emotionally broken, you can always tell. You know, there's traits. If you pick up on them early, you'll know that, okay, this guy don't retain affection that easy. You know, this dude, you can tell him because he begins to become emotionally exhausting on you, because you have to constantly provide him with reinforcements to be happy, because there's something missing in his dude. Okay? Mm-hmm. But you have to understand, you have to be able to recognize these men before you get popped, okay? And we don't, and a lot of sisters don't. A lot of, because on the surface, I'm clean cut. On the surface, I don't smoke, I don't drink. On the surface, you know, I'm in a 15th percentile of African-American men. And one of the dangerous things about a black man knowing that he's in the top 15% is he's aware that he's in the top 15%, okay? And so now you begin to realize there's less of me and more of them, okay? And a lot of sisters, they get hurt in this process because he's not really committing, or he's not really that into you, or he's just really just passing time with you until he finds her, or you just haven't realized how to break through to him mentally. So for me, the cheating was the compliments. You know, I enjoyed the compliments. I enjoyed, you know, meeting this new woman thing, and this new woman, you know, this excitement over this new woman. And it wasn't always that it was a better woman, sort.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a new woman. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of brothers, man, a lot of brothers fall in that trap where they think that, you know, this woman here is a better woman. It's just a new woman. She's just new, you know, and it's that newness. it's that newness that leads to the destruction of the Christian family. Okay, it's that new woman. That new woman. That okay, wow, man, she do everything better than the woman I got, and that ain't really the case.
Right.
It really is not. She's just new, and she's complimenting you. And that's what I had to realize, bro. And for me, I'm gonna be honest with you, man. My dad passed when I was 5. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And this was, believe it or not, man, this was something that helped me really cure me from hoeing. Right here, what I'm about to say. Back in the early 70s, man, and they still do this to this day. I don't allow my children to participate in it. But when somebody died, they stick children right in front of the coffin, right on the first pew. Okay.
Right. Yeah.
And that happened to me in the early 70s, man. I'm right on this pew. Coughing right there, my dad in the coffin, I'm on this first pew, right, looking at him, look, you know, this was normal in church culture back then, to stick children right there, you know. Dude, that traumatized me, right? I don't think it was as much of him passing as that whole coffin scene, right?
And the coffin scene.
Right, it's not really making an excuse for it, but that was a big, huge void in my life. Starting from a very young age, right? And my mama did an exceptional job, right? Can't take any credit, anything away from her at all, but there was still this coffin scene in my head.
Mm-hmm.
Even growing up through life, like I never forgot it. And it created a huge void within me that I never really felt complete. And what I would do is, as big as that hole was in the absence of my dad, I would try to stuff women into that hole.
Hmm.
Trying to get that feeling, that sense of wholeness, you know, that, okay, I'm with a woman, she's, is this something ain't right about her? It is, I don't know about her. Then I meet another good woman. She's cool in all these areas, but, you know, then I meet another woman. Yeah, you know, the sex is good, she pretty, you know, get along with everybody, but. And so every woman I meet, there was this but. I like it, but this, like it, but that, like it, but this. All to have somebody point out to me, man, look, dude, you are still in a state of grieving that has never been addressed.
Wow.
That has never been, your family never got no help for you. Nobody never really looked close at you to see what was going on and didn't have a male figure around me to say, dude, hey, young man, you screwing up. You know, why don't you sit down somewhere? Why don't you slow your roll, bruh? You know, never had that, you know. Came to the realization, sort, that men need men.
Right. Not like Eddie Long type of need them.
Not like an Eddie Long kind of way.
But you're right.
The best thing to cure a man is a man. You know what I'm saying? Is a brother who has already overcome those things, already have done. And, you know, and this brother, man, this dude helped me, bro. This dude said, man, look, bro, I'm going to tell you the truth. You broken. you are one broken man.
Wow.
That's,
so how old were you when you finally realized that, or when you had this conversation with that person? How old were you?
6.
No, the last when you got over it.
The guy who helped me?
Yeah. Yeah. How old were you when you had to come? You said 6?
36.
36. Oh, I thought you said 6. 36. Okay.
36 years old, man.
36.
Well,
okay.
All of the carnage, you know, and destruction leading up to that point, you know, had already been done, you know, at the point that, you know, I get with Renelle and everything, and I tell her all the time, you know what I'm saying, you really better be thanking God.
She would have cut you, huh?
I'm like, I used to be a monster, like, ah, you know? She ain't never met the green dude. She only got David Banner. She ain't never met the green dude, you know? And I tell her, the green dude, you know, he was a bad dude, you know? But it's by the grace of God, you know, that God allowed a brother to interact with me, man. And this man helped me to see that, dude, I don't care how many women you meet until you connect with Jesus Christ, you ain't going to be happy with nobody.
Hmm. Wow.
Jesus is the only one that can fill this void that you stuffing with women. That's it. And it was something, big man, as simple as that. It may even seem too simple to have work. But take my situation and place it into the petri dish that a lot of black men didn't have daddies. A lot of black men don't have daddies right now.
Mm-hmm.
As a woman, have you encountered a man that's still in a state of grief of losing his daddy, whether physically losing him or emotionally losing him? It could.
Good question.
As a woman, have you met somebody that it didn't matter what you did for this dude? He wanted you to wear sexy stuff, you wore sexy stuff. He wanted you to wear your hair long, you wore your hair long. He wanted you to cut it off, you turned into Anita Baker. He wanted you, whatever you wanted him to do, want to cook, dude had his food. No matter what you did for him, he still went out and found somebody. No matter how many hoops he made you jump through, talking about we're going to be a happy family together forever, just going to be me and you and the kids. He still went out and get this little chick. And you're looking at this girl and you said, you cheated on me.
With that?
Dude, you cheated on me with her? I had one girl told me, she said, I would have felt better if you would have got somebody that looked just like me. You know what I'm saying? But that was me, big dog.
Wow.
Yeah. Mm. And I wanted to really just take people into. We got calls. We got calls. I'm sorry,
okay.
As I'm running my mouth. We want to get calls. I think 859. I'm not sure. Pope of the Baptist people. 859 is live. Welcome to the Church Folk Revolution.
Well, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. This is Praise. How you doing, people?
Just having a
praise. Hey,
having it, girl. I recognize that Kentucky number because you was in York.
You know that's the Kentucky number.
What's going on?
Northern Kentucky.
You know, I came in at the right day, the right time. This is the right word for the right now, people, because this is what's really going on.
We're talking today about the Manwhore concept. What's your take? What's been your experience?
My experience, first of all, I wanted to ask the question, and I'll give you my experience, but I wanted to ask the question. I think you answered it. There was something in you that was lacking that gave you that push to, you know, when you said that you needed that affirmation and that validation within you. Every time it didn't matter about the woman because you always went after good women.
Mm-hmm.
You weren't looking for the hoe.
Right.
You was looking for the good woman.
Absolutely.
But it was the butt.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you were doing what you were doing and then the compliment stopped, there was something that was lacking within you that needed to have that affirmation, so you kept seeking.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, while I was on the phone, I heard you go through that process and say that someone at the age of 36 got with you and said, you know, hey, man, this is what you need to do. But so many people don't have that experience.
Yes.
And that's why this show today is so critical.
Thank you.
In molding, healing relationships, developing relationships, relationships that are ongoing, have died and need to be reconciled or not. You understand what I'm saying? Because we don't understand each other as men and women.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking in the chat room now, and they're asking me questions about, forget that. I'll just say, some women think like men.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to what you're talking about, what your flaming sword was talking about, they're looking for sex.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about a relationship. It's about what satisfies me right now, and that's what I want.
Yes.
My experience has been, I've been there and done all that.
Mm-hmm.
I've been cheated on. I've cheated. I've done all of that.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the kind of show that where you can become transparent and tell the truth and shame the devil.
Yes. You know, and it takes a lot for Sword to come on here and share some of the things that
Absolutely.
He shared, you know, and I'm like, wow, you know. But, you know, praise, this is the kind of direct, when we talk about a men's ministry, we still don't have real men's ministry in these churches. Right,
it's
because the majority of the whoring around is committed by the men
church.
Who are in the men's ministry.
Okay, that's
you
a whole other show, TJ.
That's a whole other show.
We ain't going to do that for that. We're not doing that today.
That's a whole other show.
Okay,
praise, you done lit the lines up, man. We got four calls holding now. Thank you, baby girl. We love you.
All right.
We love you so much. Thank you.
I love you.
Yeah, we're going to keep the calls going. Today we're talking about the man whore and curing the man whore and how to be with one woman. We got a caller from 913. 913 area code. Your call is live. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, what's going on, DJ? Flaming Sword, what's going on, Scott?
What's happening, man? What's going on? What's your take on this conversation, man? We're talking about how to be with one woman and why we cheat as a man. Share with us, brother.
Yeah, I think you guys already hit the majority of the reasons why we cheat. And like you said, you would go after the compliment, and Jonathan said he was just going after the sex.
Mm-hmm.
And some people just do it just because they can.
Yeah, just because
some
they can.
Some people do it just, And for me, I really wouldn't consider myself a whore, and I've never cheated on my wife. Now, this is before I got married. And I think a lot of it has to do with, like you said, how you grow up and your environment and where you are. Because when me and Jonathan was in Korea, when we left, the first time we'd ever been apart when we left Korea.
Mm-hmm.
He went down to Fort Campbell, and I went to Fort Leavenworth. Two totally different environments, two totally separate environments. Fort Leavenworth is more laid back. It was a bunch of officers there. It wasn't too much for the junior enlisted people to do. But down there, it was a lot of junior enlisted, a lot of more people his age, a lot more females. And I think if I was down there, I would have been worse, just as bad as he was.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think we would have been worse if we would have been
bad.
Together.
I look better than you, so.
All right, get out of here with all that.
Okay, go ahead.
I think it would have been worse if we had been together, especially being twins. And we both did a lot of dancing. I think it would have been worse. But me being where I was.
You was dancing
and,
too?
Yeah,
I
was.
You got dancing twins?
You ain't seen that video? We put this video on Facebook about it. We actually, when we was in Korea, we went on tour in Korea with some famous Korean singers.
All right, so y'all was making a wet together.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. You got me with that.
And my little experience up there in Kansas, and don't nothing go on in Kansas. I know y'all watched First 48. In Kansas City ain't no joke. But I was in like a suburb of Kansas up in Leavenworth, where Michael Vick was in Leavenworth.
Right.
But being up there, the guys I hung out with, and we had our crew name was TMF, the Mighty F Word. That was our crew name, the TMF.
The Mighty Effers?
Wow.
Yeah. No, not the Effers, just the four letters with the F on the end of it. That was our crew name. But we were slick. You know, we would never use our own phones to call these chicks. We would never do, we had to do something. We would change cars. We would change phones and everything. That's just the way that we did things. But, you know, it wasn't right. We didn't, you know, we were just doing what we had to do in order to go ahead and keep cheating and keep playing the women like we did. But I think that women were, I want to say, emotionally open to that. Because they were going after, they were looking for guys like that.
What about the moment you changed? Can you put your finger on the moment that you lost the thirst to run women?
It had to be when it kind of dwindled a little bit. Like the older I got, I really can't put my finger on it. But once I met my wife, and to be honest, I was already married when I met her. But me and my wife had been separated for like a year and a half, and I hadn't seen her in over a year. But and me and my wife now, we've been together. We had our 14th anniversary this past Monday when she was in the hospital. But when I met her, I think it was like, okay, this is it. This is the one. Because I've always chased after older women. That was my thing. I always liked older women. And the woman, when I met her, she was younger. She was the first woman that I met that was younger than me. But she was straight. She was straight up. Mm-hmm. She was like gangster.
She's a drug dealer.
She was gangster. She was.
How long can you stay on the line?
Not how long you got?
I'm at work.
Yeah,
at
work.
I'm gonna step out, take a personal call.
One quick question. Has there been a real threat to your marriage from another woman?
No, none whatsoever. Once I got saved and made a commitment to her.
Never even a relapse of Hoenn.
No, never. Because the temptation is not even there. And I can say that with all honesty.
Is she listening to this show right now? Is that why you're not?
No.
We ain't gonna tell.
That's honest. And like what Johnson was saying, I used to tell him too. I was like, the headache is not worth it. It's not worth the headache to try to cheat and then walk down the street with my wife and see a woman that I cheated on. And then I start getting all sweaty and trying to go the other way. You know, it's too much of a headache. It's not worth it.
It's too stressful.
Hey, so what I think his wife listening, bro.
Yeah, she's in the chat room. She want to guess.
We're going to let you off the hook. Hey, so we're going to continue this conversation. This is going to be a part of a series, bro, and I want you on a panel on the next one, brother.
Okay. All right.
Thank you, man of God.
All right. All right,
bye-bye. I wanted to really just sort of put him on the spot a little bit because from time to time, sometimes there's a woman who can challenge your position of I'm gonna be with one woman. Sometimes you'll see somebody that'll be like, it could be somebody from your past, man. It could be somebody you just met, or it can be the chick that you have just run into is your type. Men have types, you know. Men have those. There is this type. Sometimes, ladies, you're not really his type. He just decided that you're so much of a good woman that I'm gonna go the distance with you. But he still has a type. Now, sometimes you are his type, like. The ideal type of woman that he would want, you're that type, right? But sometimes you wasn't that type, and he runs into it. He runs into it on his job, this woman they just hired. She got the booty. She got the hair. She got the lips. She's smart. She dressed like a lady. Whether you like dark-skinned women, she dark-skinned. Whether you like light-skinned women, she light-skinned. And she's available. Is the, you know, you're not going to get tempted with something that you don't want. I ain't never been tempted with somebody I didn't want. I've always been tempted with that profile of the type of woman that I like. Now, I'm not just saying this because she is the producer of this show, but the Pulpit of Baptist People just happens to be my type.
Sure, TJ.
You don't want to get cut.
I'm not saying that because she's the person that fixed the food, but I'm just saying that she is the type. Now, here's what makes her, you know, sort of threatening to her position is I like intelligent women. So it's not really like a physical thing that I like. More of that, they gotta be intelligent women. Like, I was on a date one time, right? And I had this girl in my hand, bro. She was done deal. Like, I didn't have no more work to do with this chick. I had to put in all of the work, right, within 72 hours, okay? So we're on a date, right? And she said something that made me realize I can't do this. You know, I just can't do this, you know?
Uh-oh.
And I'm trying to have a conversation with her, you know, and this girl, and you know, this girl thought George W. Bush Sr. and George W. Bush Jr. was the same person.
Huh. What do you think, Jessica Simpson?
And I'm sitting there, this was one of those check please moments at the table, you know, you're like, check. Because no matter how fine this chick was, I realized that at this table, I can't do this.
Oh,
you know what I'm saying? And this was what, Rennell, this was when Bush was president, all right? So don't be running at me. But it's before Obama, which means that you're in the clear. But I'm sitting at this table and I say, man, I can't do dumb chicks. I can't do it. And so I knew what my type was. My type was they had to be really, really smart, right? I mean, of superior intelligence. I ain't talking about doing algebra and nothing. I just know, just keep up with current.
Hold a conversation.
Got an opinion about something and follow the news. You know what I'm saying? And know that we got an election coming up this year. I mean, next year in 2012. You know, just a woman that I can talk to, right? And she had to have soft hair, right? Didn't like spritz hair. Didn't like, you know, got to have soft hair, right? So if she was smart, she had soft hair, and she could wear a dress from time to time, right?
Mm-hmm.
She wore a dress, you know? Oh, if she wore a dress on a date, oh, she got me, right? That was my type, you know? And so this was very important for me, guys, and this is important in what I'm in our trying to provide help for Manwhore. Men have types, brothers, and if you're listening to this show, you're listening to me right now, probably the reason you keep falling in the traps and falling in the holes with holes is that because you have...
Great, what you say? falling in the holes with holes.
All right, moving on. It's because you have yet to realize you have a type. Now, if the woman that you're with is not exactly your type, here's the moment, like our first caller said, that you need to be honest. It's not the end of the world. It's not the end of the relationship, okay? But you have to first be honest with yourself, brother, that I possibly could be with a woman that is not my type, or my type has changed since I met her. That still is not the end of the relationship. Here's why. Women are very flexible. I ain't talking about physically flexible, okay? I'm talking about flexible, meaning that I've discovered this, and this actually helped me, Sword. This helped me a lot. Like, if I go to my lady and express something that I like, she'll try to accommodate me, right? And the first time I suggested something to Rennell and she tried to, like, do it, I was like, wow, that was easy. It was like I hit the easy button, you know, like the easy button was like a booty, you know, it's like, boom, easy button. And I'm just like, just slap the easy button on the booty, you know. She did that. I mean, she did it, you know, and I was like, wow, that was easy, you know. But in the past, sword, I would have went out to find it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Instead of asking them,
that's friends, bruh. Fellas, listen to me. Listen to me. Ask your lady for it. Mm. Okay. Just try it. Trust me on it. Trust me on this, what I'm about to say. Okay, because my first marriage, I destroyed it because I didn't ask her for it. Okay, what you talking about, TJ? When I met my first wife, right, she was one of the finest women in Louisiana, okay? And I liked that, you know? She was, you know, I was young, bro. You know, when you're 24, 25, 26.
Oh, yeah.
Went to trophies, you know what I'm saying?
Right,
right. Right, and so, in so many ways, she was my trophy, okay? Can we talk about real stuff on this show?
Yeah, let's be real.
Okay. Cause I know Elgin ain't on there, but we just say it's real talk. I know Elgin don't come on this Sunday, but we talking real talk. And she got fat on me, bro.
Oh.
All right. She got big on me. Now, I didn't like this. Because what defined this relationship was you so fine. Right? Like, when I bring you to the basketball court and you over there watching me play basketball, it's understood with all of these other dudes out here, she with T.
She with you. Mm-hmm.
Fine. Right? When I take you to the Christmas party and I take you to all the stuff, you know what I'm saying? That's understanding. That was the role that we had. So now she done changed it up. Right? Not intentionally, right? But, you know, she started working a night job. Guys, man, if you can prevent it, don't let your lady work at night. I'm telling you. You go get two jobs and a lawnmower to keep your lady from working at night, all right? Because night jobs make people fat, okay? So she's, because you're eating when you're supposed to be sleeping. You know what I'm saying? You're just eating all night. Your body saying, hey, we're supposed to be asleep, and you're eating, you know? So
mm-hmm.
Started working this night job, right? And she blew up on me. That was a problem, right? That was a problem because now I don't – ain't nobody downloaded a program in me to tell me how to act when your wife done got big on you. I couldn't handle it. Couldn't handle it, bro. Didn't have no brother in my life to say, hey, man, you know, that's all right, you know. That's all right. She done put on some pounds, but, you know, you can work with that. You know, pounds are temporary. That's not permanent.
Right.
Pounds. There's nothing permanent about pounds, you know? Work with her, bro. Work with her.
Wow.
But what I did instead of working with her is I tore her apart emotionally. I was so angry with the weight that she was gaining that I tore her down. I tore down her self-esteem because I didn't have the maturity to deal with it.
Right. It probably made her eat more. Yeah, and TJ, I just want to tell you, man, I really appreciate your transparency with this, man, because you could really be helping people just now, man, just because people need to hear this.
I tore her apart.
I needed to hear it.
I tore her apart, man. I'm serious. I was once speaking, right,
mm-hmm.
And I was boasting. Right, I was speaking to somebody, right? I think it was a group of men or something. I was speaking, and I was boasting, right, how I have never hit a woman, you know? Like, I don't hit women. Like, I don't put my hands on women. And I'm boasting and talking about I've never hit a woman, never hit a woman. She got wind of this wonderful message, this wonderful speech I gave to these people. And she said, you know what, it's true that you have never hit me. It was true that during the course of our relationship, you never hit me. She said, and this is about 10 years later, guys. This is about 10, 15, 12 years later, because we got divorced in 99, 2000. She said, But some of the things that you said to me, I would have much rather you hit me.
Wow.
Because I haven't healed from some of the things you said to this day, you know. And I wanted to share this story with brothers because sometimes because you're not emotionally mature enough to handle changes in your woman, it can cause you to act out in the worst way. And it can cause you to say some things because you're not happy with her changing on you. Right? When she changed on me, I took it personal. How dare you do this to me? You know? How dare
man.
You know I didn't like no big woman. How dare you get big on me? I thought this stupidness was coming out of my mouth at this time. You know what I mean? But when I look back on it, bruh, you know, weight was so temporary. And this was a good woman, bruh. This woman that I threw away because of weight and pounds and cheated on her because of weight, her weight and her pounds, was a very good woman. And a lot of us are throwing away good women because we can't handle the changes of life.
Man.
So this time, right, Rinell and had two babies back to back, bro.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't even remember having that much sex, but two babies came back. Right? You know, we in the hospital, one playoffs, right? Then we next year the Saints in the Super Bowl, we right back at the hospital.
Wow.
We were in the hospital. These two kids I got right now, bro, they I think they 9 months apart, huh, Rinell? She bad, bro.
We have a show Monday.
It's possible for children to be 9 months apart, but I got two here that's 9 months apart. Right?
Uh-huh.
And she, you know, she put on a couple of pounds, right?
Uh-oh.
But the difference in me now and with the first wife is we joined the gym together.
Mm-hmm.
We joined the gym together. And we working out together. You know, I didn't do that the first time. I cheated, you know? And one of the reasons when we talked about Sword said he cheated because of sex. I cheated because of compliments. I also cheated because of the change. You know, something shifted up on me. Something changed on me, and I didn't really have an understanding of the commitment for the long haul, you know? Now I understand the commitment for the long haul. It's not that I'm at some great arrival. Right, I am, but I still got a long way to go, you know, because there's still some areas that I struggle with. You know, I'm a recovering addict, and so being a recovering addict, you know, there's still certain situations I keep myself out of, certain things I try to do that help out. But I think, and I want to get your opinion on this. Describe your commitment to the long haul. Did we lose sound? Testing 1, 2. Rinell, I lost sound. Hey, we lost Jonathan. All right, I lost Jonathan. Let's try to get Jonathan back in. But overall, guys, while we work out a brief little technical issue, I thought everybody was knocked off, but we just knocked Jonathan. I got to get Jonathan back on, so we're gonna dial him back in. But for me personally, guys, I wasn't able to adjust to the change, and now the difference. And I'm just trying to help men, so sisters, just bear with me in this conversation. I'm not really talking to you, okay? I'm talking to men. I think that you have to make a commitment within yourselves, brothers, where you say to yourself, okay, regardless of what happens emotionally or physically, I'm here for the long haul, okay? Because there is a possibility that your woman could gain weight. Gaining weight is one of the reasons for cheating, okay? It is one of the reasons. Quite often, we cheat with people that are smaller. Move, Rennell. I'm trying to tell a story. Rennell standing on side of me. I'm just trying to tell her. I'm trying to tell her.
Okay.
Typically, we cheat with people.
I'm back.
Okay, we got him back. We got him back. But the question that I was asking, man, right when everything fell out on us is, talk about your commitment to the long haul. Regardless of the change, regardless of the shifts, regardless, 300 pounds, 120 pounds. Share with me.
I think for me, it's about life, man. It's about the journey. We're going through it. Because, I'm pretty sure I done put on weight. You know, so I hate to say that. I've changed. We all change and evolve. And the commitment to the long haul, man, we got kids. Mm-hmm. I got to see my kids grow up, man. I want them to grow up in a healthy environment as far as the parents together, man. And it got to be a commitment on both ends. It got to be. Because, I would look at my wife and say, she done gained weight. I can look at her and say, well, she done changed. She don't do this no more. She don't do that no more. And then some of it is true. But some of it is doesn't really matter. It's just my wants. And it is a commitment.
Have you expressed your want to your wife? Like,
oh, yes.
You go to her. How does she handle it when you come to her and express a want? Like, I want you to be smaller.
Let's see. Well, when I talked to her, she said, okay, we'll work on it. We'll work on it. And
worked on it?
Sometimes she'll work on it, and then it'll fall off. You know, she'll work on it for a few months, and then it'll fall off, you know. And then I got to get back on again. Okay, honey, let's go. You know, you see, I'm losing weight. I need come on, go on this journey with me. Let's go together.
Right.
And she ain't going for a little while, but then it fall off again. And so I just bring it back up.
Mm-hmm.
And with maturity, I learned. See, when we first got married, I used to get angry. I used to get mad and,
right.
You know, we used to fight. But I learned you got to have patience. Long-suffering.
Mm-hmm.
Long-suffering. And it's well worth it, man. It's worth it. It's worth the struggle, the fight. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just saying, I agree with you 100% that it absolutely is worth it. Another reason men cheat, and I want to address this one. I want to get your take on this one too, Sword, is beginning to feel inadequate within the marriage or the relationship. Needing to be the hero of the relationship, needing to be the man of the relationship financially. Some brothers can't handle their wives making more money than they do. Okay? Well, TJ, how do somebody cheat in that? They go hook up with a chick who got less money than them.
Yeah.
That their money can impress them. You know? And there are moments, you know, within a relationship that I felt inadequate. You know, I felt in or that I didn't measure up, you know, or there was a possibility that she, I don't know, wondering if I'm really pleasing her, wondering mm-hmm. if it's still good to her, wondering if she's still, if I still do it for her, right?
Right.
I'm just going to talk.
Be real.
It, right?
I got you.
Why does a man cheat for those reasons? Because the pursuit and the hunt of the new woman becomes validation that I still have it.
Yeah.
We need to know that we got it, right? Like, we need to believe that we're really pleasing you in every way. I'm not just talking about sex. I'm talking about in every way. You know, Stevie Wonder song is song. Do I do what mm-hmm. you do when you do my thing to you? How you go? Do I do what you do? Yeah, that's it. Do I do what you do when I do the thing to you?
mm-hmm.
I think think that's it. I'm not sure. Somebody help me out. Somebody get the lyrics to that song so I can make sure I got it right. But I think I'm close to it. We want to know that, you know, we're still compatible in every way. And whenever there's some sort of doubt there, and this is, guys, this is why communication amongst married people is so important, right? It's because if you just share with them, or not when they ask for it, you know, not when he asks for it, ladies, not when he asks for it, but when you just let him know, like, I'm gonna give you a way right now, to cure a lot of issues with your man. And I'm telling you, I'm gonna loan this to you. This is a loan. All right,
a free one.
It's a loan. I'm probably not even supposed to say this, but I'm gonna say it. Right, I may get subpoenaed by the man council after I say what I'm gonna say after we come back from this quick break. When we come back from this quick break, ladies, I'm going to share with you one thing that you can do today, that will fix so many things going on inside of your man. It may even keep him away from Tamika.
Uh-uh.
Might. But it's worth a try. We're going to come right back after this break for the Flaming Sword of the Revolution. It's your boy, TJ, and you're listening to the Churchfolk Revolution Radio! Revolution Radio with your host, the Flaming Sword of the Revolution, and your boy from the Night Boy, DJ. We got a great show for you today. Today we're talking about how to cure the man whore. How to prevent your man from wilding out. A couple of tips and strategies that could help save your marriage from people that were former man whores. Yeah, and I think it was important that we come from that perspective of men who have ran the whole gamut of running women and chasing them down, whether it was just sex or whether it was a need for something emotional, and to finally arrive at a point where that particular woman works for them and they chill out, you know. So there's something amazing when a brother chills out.
It is.
It is. Unbelievable.
Hmm.
You know, and we have it amongst our friends. You know, whenever we have, you know, our friends a chill out, men will give them a hard time and call them hen-picked, all of these little names. Ah, boy, she got you whipped. Ah, look at he going home. Ah, dude, you done talked to her four times since you got over here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's like men don't celebrate other men who are trying, you know? And I've even been guilty of that. Like, oh, there you go. There you go. The ball and chain. Ah. And, you know, but when I look back on it, I should have been celebrating this brother. Like, man, this dude is trying because it's hard. You know?
Yeah, yeah. And it's funny you mention that because that's another reason why a lot of men cheat, because of peer pressure.
The pressure to cheat.
The peer pressure, yep.
The pressure.
Yep.
We talked about it, man. The pressure to do it, and then it's stuff that we talk about, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, and I, this is going to sound crazy to a lot of women, but I'm about to say this. Y'all know I'm going to say it. Sometimes when we get together, we don't really want to talk about what we doing sexually to you.
Because
that becomes, you know? To some, you know, to talk about, but we'll talk about what we doing sexually to her, right? Man, I did this, man, I did that, and boom, 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 and she could do this and she could do that, right? So the other chick, we'll talk about the things that we do with her, right?
Right.
But we're not gonna quite tell them what we're doing with you, because you're the main one.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Right.
Like being called the main one, but you the main one, right? Take a bow. That's something good. Yeah, you know, you're the main one, right? And so this, it also leads to men cheating, right? In order to be able to have something to share in these conversations.
That's it. Yeah.
And so part of another reason we do it is because of that. And I know that's one of the minor ones, but I have seen men go out and get somebody so they can have somebody to talk about in these conversations.
Hmm.
All right. And right before the break, I said, there is something that you can do today, right, that will help your marriage, that will help. It'll help your man. Like, this is something you could do. This is better than a Christmas present. It's better than a lingerie night. Save some. You can save a little of that money from Victoria's Secret, and just do what I'm asking you to do. It don't require no hoops at all. Here's what I want you to do. Drum roll, Renee. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go find your man, wherever he's at, whether he's in the house or he's at work. You can even pull this off at work. It's rated G. Okay. I want you to walk right up to him. I want you to take your left hand and your right hand and press him up against his face. Right? Hold his face in your hand. Okay? In your hands. In between your hands. Squeeze just a little bit so he thinks something about to happen to him. He don't know what's going on. Right? Right now you got his undivided attention. The moment you touch a man in his face, you have his undivided attention, because we're territorial and that's real close. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Put your hands on his face and squeeze just a little bit. And say the following words. You are the only man for me. The things that you do for me and to me, no other man
compares to you. I thank God for you. Kiss him. Mwah, and leave. Don't stay there after you say it because you're going to mess it up. All right? I want you to leave. Okay? Either go somewhere or go in the bathroom, lock the door, go sit in your car. But leave him. Right? Leave him alone with what you've just said. The touch on the face and those words. Okay? Why does that work, TJ? Why does that work? Number one, God created us in his own image. There are some characteristics of God that we share. And as God loves praise, we love praise. As God loves intimate relationships with him, we also love intimate relationships with our woman.
Mm-hmm.
Things like this that provide us with the reinforcement. Because the woman that's going to take your man, she's not going to take him with sex. She's going to say something. Either that something is a simple yes, you can have some, or that something is, wow, you're awesome. Or that something is, you're the only man for me. There is no man that can do the things that you do. I thank God that he has given me a man just like you. Now just imagine for a second if another woman has said those words to your man. I'll give y'all a moment. All right. So before she do it, okay, do something that Tamika can't do right now because she don't have the opportunity to. You're alone with him. You're right there with him, okay? Make use of some of this time that y'all are together and put your hands on his face. Grab him by the face, almost like your auntie used to do. Remember your auntie? Oh, you're just so cute. Look at you. Just like your daddy. Do that. Okay? I promise you, sisters, it's the beginning. It's not the sum total, but it's the beginning of reinforcing. You never know. You could have a TJ on your hand, right, and don't know it yet because he ain't started acting out yet. So before he turns into a TJ, put your hands on his face and give him what he need. Just give him what he need. What he needs is to know from you, not from the people around him. He needs to know from you that he is all you need. You don't want no other man but him. Say it to him. Just try it. When was the last time you walked up to your man and said, you know what, I don't want another man but you? Just say it. Just say it to him. Because he could be dealing with some insecurities that he's too much of a man to show you.
Mm-hmm.
Too mannish to even let you know what he needs. Like, he don't want you to think that he's emotionally weak, right? So I'm trying to help you out, right? I'm going to save a hope. I'm trying to help you out. Don't give her an opportunity to say something to your man. You say it. You say it first. Yeah, y'all doing the sex thing. Yeah, that's happening. Yeah, you've made sex readily available and accessible to him. Okay, that's fine. But if you're giving him all the sex he wants and none of the words he needs, you're right back in the same place you started.
Yep.
So that's my advice for the sisters out there, to cure a man from a lot of issues. Sword, you'll go.
Man, that was powerful what you just said. It's powerful. Because a man needs to know that he's a man. He got to feel it. He got to know that you trust him, that you need him. Because we as men, we are fixers. We want to fix it.
Mm-hmm.
And he got to know that he is needed in a relationship. So if you belittling your man, if you berating him, telling him he ain't no man, he can't do this right, can't do, you pushing him away. You pushing him into, to use the TJ's word, into Tamika's arms.
Yeah, you gonna go right to Tamika.
You pushing him into Tamika's arms. So don't berate him, don't belittle him. If he is what you say he is, encourage him to do better.
Mm-hmm.
And that will encourage him. And I'm gonna go a little step further and say, give him some, because there's a lot of marriages where men ain't getting none.
the hot some.
Yeah, he can get some. I'm telling you.
Give him the show off booty. That's what I call it. The show off booty. You know the sex you put on him when you were showing off in the beginning.
Oh, show off booty.
Give him the show off booty. Yeah.
Right. Because like you said earlier, we become complacent in a relationship. We come complacent and, yeah, here we go. It's all dry. You just laying there. No, make him want you. And give, because I know I got a friend right now who he stopped confiding in me because I would tell him to quit cheating on his wife.
Mm-hmm.
And so he don't confide in me. He don't talk to me no more about that. Because he know what I'm going to say. And I understand why he cheats. I don't condone it, but I understand. His wife is not affectionate. He said he likes to hug. He likes to sit on the couch with his wife underneath him and watch a movie, and she don't do that. He got to beg. He said he's lucky if he get it once a month.
That ain't gonna work.
So I understand why you cheating, but I don't condone it. Y'all need to get together and talk.
Get together. Something. There's been a breakdown there.
Yep.
You know, and he did something to her. Women don't just cut it off like that unless he done did something. I know. He did something to her,
right? To make her shut it completely down. I know it. I have a relationship. I'm trying to help, you know, walk them through. That's going through the same thing. She tore him down with the words. You know, he mm-hmm. tear her down with absence. Like the way he protests at the way she talked to him is he leave,
disappear.
He leave in the morning.
And
come back. he come back when the 10 o'clock news on,
what?
You know? And I said, you know, I necessarily don't think this brother is cheating. She said, why do you don't think he's cheating? Why do you don't think he be going all day? He be going all day. He said, he needs somewhere to sleep, but his home is not within you. You know?
Right.
It's no longer,
right.
He don't want to come home to you. He don't want to be bothered with the way you feel. Going back to words. Going back to words, what you say to your man matters.
Yep.
The words that come out of your mouth, listen, ladies, I'm trying to help, man. I'm trying to help save some of this stuff. The words that come out of your mouth matter. How you know that, TJ? What makes you so sure that what Jesus said, who do some say that I am? Some say it's thou or John the Baptist. Some say that you are Elijah. Some say that after he let them run through a whole gambit of what some say, he turns right to the same disciples and said, well, who do you say that I am?
Mm-hmm.
What you say to me matter.
Yep.
I'm not concerned about what some say, but what you have. You're the one I'm with every day. You're the one I walk with. You're the one I talk with. You're the one I sleep with. Who do you say that I am? What do you have to say about me? That means far more than anything else. What you have to say to the things that you say to your man matters. Even if it's small, remember. And we about to get on me and Sword. Gonna get out your way in a little bit. Compliment him. I don't care how small. I don't care how big. Compliment him. I don't care if he always do it. Compliment that. I don't care if he always come home at a certain time. And he married to me, he better be home at a certain time. Compliment that he always come home at a certain time. Whatever behaviors you like about your man, compliment those behaviors.
constant. Come up with ways to compliment. I got one better for you. I got a real good one.
Uh-oh. What you got?
Go get you some loose leaf paper from Walgreens and an ink pen and write him something. Y'all still know how to write in cursive, right? Write him something. Okay? Write him something. It could be two paragraphs. Okay? Write him something on a sheet of paper. All right? I'm going to help y'all. I'm going to give it to y'all, okay? I'm doing all the work for y'all today, all right? I'm going to help y'all. Hi, sweetie. I just wanted to take a moment of my day just to let you know how much I appreciate you, period. When you came home the other night and you were tired and everything and you came in and you kissed me, you know, that really made me feel good. And it got me thinking that I really need to do little things for you so to let you know how good I feel being your woman, period. I love you and I love everything that you do for me and this family. When I think about my friends and all of the problems and the issues they're having in their relationships, and I think about the awesome job you're doing as my husband, you are worthy of me stopping my day just to say thank you. Thank you for, I know it's not your birthday, I know it's not a holiday, but I just wanted to acknowledge you for being an honest, hard-working man of God. You are an awesome example for other men, and I'm grateful and honored to be your woman. The end.
Amen.
Amen. I just scrambled that off the top of my head, but y'all know the dude, okay? So you could take your letter and make your letter sort of craft your letter to really fit him. You know, it don't have to be generic like the one I just gave, but try it, because here's what's going to happen. He going to read that letter about 79 times. Okay? He's going to read it about 79 times. It was a handwritten letter. Remember back in high school, you used to write handwritten letters.
Mm-hmm.
Come on. You done got one, sword.
Yep.
Back at the bottom of it, they circle page 2. Page 3. Page 4.
With the right. Hearts for the dot on the eye?
Yeah. So the strategy here is that a lot of brothers, you know, you never know. He may be at a dilemma trying to decide on if he's going to holler, but he got your letter in the car. You follow me? He may get hit up from somebody old on Facebook, but he remembers something you said to him in a letter. Your words will pop into your man head at a moment of decision. That's why I want you to constantly say things to him, right? And just like Sword said, you know, him and his lady take a day. I think that's absolutely awesome, man, to take a day out the week and reflect on where you are. Ask him, is there something that he wants you to work on?
Trust me, it works.
Ask him, are you hitting on all cylinders? Don't assume that you are. Ask him, okay? And to the fellas, I say this. And to the fellas, you know, there are a lot of sisters out there. There are a lot of available sisters. There are a lot of sisters out there that it's true. You can find another woman. You can get one very easy. We've already established that. We have already established that it don't take no effort at all to get the hook up with somebody. Like, that's the easiest thing to do. Like, some of these women want somebody to fool with them just as bad as you want to fool with them. So that don't take any work. What takes a lot of work is to grab one of them and go the distance with that one. Like, this right now is one of the hardest challenges for me because I would have been quit by now on anybody else. I had already told Rennell, I have gone further than I've gone with anybody.
It's maturity.
You
plus, you're scared Rennell to cut you.
You know what I'm saying? Dude, I'm figuring this out as I go because it wasn't really no handbook on how to do this thing. You know, so this is like on the job training on how to be with one person. Hmm. Has it been easy? Nope. Nope.
Nope.
Not at all. I took a friend of mine out the other night for his birthday, right? And we went, you know, I'm trying to show him a good time. And, you know, we went to this place off of Bourbon, right? You know, a little party atmosphere, you know. And I'm just standing up there, and they playing a song, Girl Come Stand Up On Me, Shaking Her Booty. Shake it like a shark, shake it like a shark. Now, boom. You know what I mean? Dude, I ain't do nothing. I'm just standing up here, okay? Mm. And she walks in front of me, turn around, and just starts shaking.
Shaking like a dog. Shaking like a dog.
You know? I came home and I told Rennell about it. I say I was just standing up there and she was just shaking on me. And she said, "Well, what you did?" You know? I said, "Well, I backed up, I backed up, you know, and you know, but you know, I said for what it's worth, I thought about you." I said, our booty was just going. I said, I'm about to go home to Rennell. I did. That's what I told her. I said, you know, she made me think about you, you know, because you could, you know, because I always joke Rennell. I always go up to her and I start doing bounce music. You know, I try to get her to pop something like, go, in the shaking, and the popping. I'll just do the beat. And she don't never want to shake nothing. That's the problem. I'm gonna shake something for a brother. You know, I'm married to you.
Some strange for a little strange.
Shake something. I said, this girl in the club can just come. Yeah, I was at a party with my friend. You know, I could go to a party. Jesus went to parties. I was at a party with my friend. And I'm standing up there, and here comes some random person, you know? And I said, man, I said, dude, it's time for me to go, bro. Because I'm an addict, bro. You know, I'm an addict. I'm a recovering addict, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when if you're a recovering crack addict and your friends start taking out the pipe, you know it's time to go. You know?
Yep.
It's time to go, you know? And for me, the pipe was this girl shaking like this, you know? It's time for me to go. So I take off, big dog, and I go home, you know, and Rennell mad as a six-shooter when I get home, you know, because it's about 11:30. I'm always in the house earlier than this. You know, so she mad, you know? And when I get there, I'm going to tell this story right now. I am going to tell this story. It's radio. So when I got home, right, she in the mirror straightening her hair and putting on lipstick and makeup and stuff, right?
Uh-huh.
I said, what you doing? She said, I'm about to go out. You've been out all day. I'm about to
11:30.
I said, well, here the keys. I'll see you when you get back, you know? But and I just wanted to share that, bro. It's a wonderful arrival for me, bro. And I just wanted to share it. I wanted to have this show for some brothers out there who may be struggling. You know, there may be some men out there that are wrestling with being committed, that are wrestling with being faithful and being with one woman. LLQC, Lisa Carter, came on our show the other night and said the reason y'all having problems with child support is because that's the sin that came along with the lifestyle you was living. You had children with different women, and this is what comes along with that sin.
Consequences.
This is the consequences of those sins.
Mm-hmm.
So don't cry about the child support because you fully walked into that area of sin in your life. And brothers, I'm telling you, when you decide to wild out on your woman, there's going to be some consequences. Don't think that you're going to get away with this and you're going to be unscathed. It could be a disease. It could be a baby. Or, you know, it could be equally as bad. You destroy the woman that you're with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, get a stalker. Oh, my God.
So take this time.
Oh.
If you're having problems, man, with your lady, go talk to her, bro. As I pass at the sword, go talk to your lady. Go whatever it is, whatever you think Tamika gonna do for you. And we're using Tamika figuratively. So if you got your name out there, your name Tamika. I'm not picking on you. I'm just using a person named Tamika. Whatever Tamika has said that she's going to do for you when you get to her house, your woman can do the same thing, bruh. Whatever Tamika says she going to cook, your woman can cook. Tamika can open the door and draws and bra. Guess what? Your woman can open the door with draws and bra too. Maid, got to put the kids to sleep, but your woman could do that too. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Point of making whatever has been promised to you by the chick, by Tamika, your wife can do it. So it.
Yep, I just want to say that it ain't worth it, man. It is not worth it. Because you cheating, well, I'm speaking from my perspective. Cheating for an 8-second climax, if it's even last 8 seconds.
Eight.
Maybe 6 seconds. A climax. Is it really worth devastating your wife? Is it really worth losing your family over Tamika? Mm-hmm. It's not worth it, man. And the joy that you have from being with one woman and not having that stress of having to sneak around and hiding your cell phones and, you know, locking your phone and hiding, changing voice messages and all that stuff, man, it ain't worth it.
Mm-hmm.
It ain't worth it.
Not worth it, man.
It ain't worth it. And then just if you get caught, and I'm going to talk about my daddy just got caught probably a couple years ago cheating on my mom.
Mm-hmm.
Just got caught. He's been whoring around for a long time. And his girlfriend had came over to the house.
Mm-hmm.
Well, my mom had just stepped out to go get some prescriptions. She come back, the girl parked in the driveway. Mm-hmm. And my mama walk up over on the porch. You know, and they've been married for 38 years.
Yes, Lord.
38 years. And he feels like he got to go out there and get. And the girl about my age. So she got herself a sugar daddy, and he thinking he's doing something because he still need to feel like he got it. And it ain't worth it, man.
Mm-hmm.
It is not worth it. It is not worth it. So, man, keep the mouse in the house.
Keep them in the house, man.
Mouse in the house.
You know what else is a good strategy, fellas? Creep with your wife.
Yeah.
Yeah. Creep with her. If you just got to have the fix, got to get your fix of creeping, creep with her. Get a hotel room with her. Schedule, call her on the phone. Ask her what she doing. What color panties you got on.
Mm-hmm.
Do all of the stuff, all of the little stuff you do with Tamika, doing with her. She'll play along. Trust me. She'll play along. She like it. Your lady just as nasty as you are. You just you ain't pushed it yet. Trust me on it. Do it. She'll do it with you. She'll play along with you. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Creep with your wife. It'll be fun, man. Because what you're infatuated with, what you're excited about, is the excitement of somebody new. But trust me on this. You haven't ran the whole gamut on the woman that you're with. Every week I learn something new about this girl I got. Right? Every time, learn something new this morning. You know? And I'm still discovering things. And so, instead of starting a whole new discovery process with somebody else, do it with her. You know, ladies, and finally, you know, finally, ladies, men, we go through phases. We do. I went through three phases. Okay, I had my conquering phase. Okay, this I call it my Flavor Flav phase. I got them lined up, and I'm trying to see who gonna be the one. All right. Then I had my Bill Cosby phase. Okay, whereas I'm presenting a perfect picture of a good man, but all of a sudden somebody knock at the door and it's some girl named Summer and saying she my daughter.
Okay? Oh.
I done had that phase. I look like I'm a good man, and I look like I got it all together, and I look like, but all of a sudden, ding dong, yeah, it's your baby. You're the baby daddy. We on Murray Pulverage. Okay.
Wow.
Then there's the final stage, and I call it an arrival, right? I call it my Denzel phase. Okay. I got this woman. I'm cool with this woman. I know I can have other women. I like this one. I'm a chill with this one. This one works for me. This one is cool for me. I enjoy this one. She make me laugh. Even when I get mad with her, I'm not mad enough to pack up my stuff. I just don't like her that day. I don't mean that I want to go hoe out. I just don't like her that day. Not that I don't like her all the time, but today, I don't want to look at her. That's an arrival for me. I had to get to that point. Because I used to, when somebody made me mad, go out and find somebody else. It's time to put Lil Wang on the radio, get in the car, and ride. Now, I'm just mad with her today.
Oh.
But I love her all the time. So, fellas, I need you to recognize what phase you are. Your Flavor Flav, your Bill Cosby, your Denzel. Ladies, I need you to understand where he's at. You got a Flavor Flav, you got a Bill Cosby, you got a Denzel. The quicker both of y'all determine that, the happier you're going to be.
Oh.
That's our show for the day. So, can you close us out in prayer?
Yep. Father, we just thank you for what we said today. We pray that it will go out and touch some men and even some women, Lord. We pray that our words have an effect, Lord God, and people can grow and understand from the conversation that we had. Father, we thank you for the callers that called in and gave their input. And we pray that these words have a true effect down into our bones, into our marrow, into our very souls, Lord, where we can change. For those men who are still out there playing the streets, we pray that they would get a word from you from this show. I thank you for letting us have the opportunity to put this out there. We thank you for the Church Folk Revolution. We thank you for the people who are listening today live. We thank you for the people who will listen later. And we thank you that we can even have this conversation in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And let the Church Folk Revolution say amen. Guys, that's our show for today. Sword, good show, bro.
All right, man. Appreciate it. It was a good show, man.
Good show. We just wanted to talk about it. I know this link is going to bounce around, right? And being that, you know, a lot of our links are bouncing around, especially the shows that's getting down into the mess, like Preacher Mess and all of this. But we want this link to bounce around as well. There are some people that you know, or may even be you, that's going through something, especially if it's a situation with cheating and then caught somebody cheating, or you think somebody cheating. You know, just pass it to them. Just slide it to them. You know, it may help them out. It may help you out in the process. We have another show coming up on Sundays with Brother Elgin. So what's coming up on Sunday?
I think it's going to be Church in the Hood, man. Church in the Hood.
The part of church. The Impotent Church series, Churches,
yes.
In the Hood.
Churches, what are they effective? What are they doing? A while ago, I drove through a few of my neighborhoods
yep.
and made some videos, about a lot of the churches, the number of churches that we have, and it's amazing at the number of churches in the hood and the state of the hood.
Mm-hmm.
With all the churches that we have, should they look better?
Mm-hmm.
And just a quick preview, I drove for no more than 15 minutes.
Yep.
And I ran across 26 churches. That's almost 2 churches a minute.
Wow.
Almost 2 churches a minute. Amazing.
That article stood up on Preacher at the top for like 2 months.
Right.
You know?
For a while.
Purposely.
Yep. Church in the hood.
Intentionally. Churches in the hood, guys. Go check it. So I don't know if you have that link. Put that link back in the chat room for those. Check out Churches in the Hood. Brother Elgin will be here on Sunday with twins. I had one of them on my show today. The other one called into the show. But the next time, we're going to do a part 2 to curing the manwhore, curing brothers that have issues with staying committed. We're gonna do a part 2 to this. We'll let you know when we're going to announce it. I'm going to have the twins on and some other people that's going to come on and share their stories of why they cheated. We're going to have that for you next time. Don't miss it. But that's our show. We want to thank the Pope of the Baptist people. Girl, take us out of here for allowing me to have these conversations and to bring you into our marriage in work in progress.
Amen. Hey, well, TJ, I hope that you will still be alive for the show on Monday.
I'm going to hit that easy button. No.
I got you.
Easy. Hit the music, girl. We out of here. As always, remember Illinois' blessing. Don't forget about illinoisblessing.org as they make an attempt to pay somebody a light bill during this time. We got an effort that's ongoing. I don't want to close it out. It's ongoing to help somebody whose light is turned off right now. Go to illinoisblessing.org. We're trying to help one family get their lights turned on. As for me and my crew, we're going to do our part for the sword of the revolution. This is your boy TJ from the Night Water, New Orleans, and you've been listening to the Churchfolk Revolution Radio!